text being in verse 20, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20. For you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So sharing with you again tonight from this theme of glorify God in your body. Going back to the 12th verse of the 6th chapter of 1 Corinthians, Paul wrote, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. And this morning we shared with you how in not being brought under the power of anything, things are to be our servants, or that we can use for the glory of God. We're not to be enslaved unto things. Amen? Not to be brought under the power of any of these things. And we talked about bringing the body under subjection. And the scriptural term for this, I believe, is the term of temperance. Temperance is one of the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. This temperance has to do with self-control and being able to restrain our appetites and our desires and keep them in balance with the will of God. And so the next verse, very next verse here, after naming temperance as one of the fruit of the Spirit, said against such there is no law, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. We're talking about glorifying God with our body. And in order to do that, we've got to have our affections set on the right thing. We've got to have our priorities straight. We've got to have our first love to God, not to self. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 6 states, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. What are you seeking for? What's your goal in life? What is your passion? What are you going after? Seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things of the earth. Did you know Jesus even said in one place, if you're going to follow me, you must hate your father and mother. Now, what in the world did he mean in saying such a thing? I believe the idea is that by comparison, our affection for God should be so much greater until could not be found what might seem appropriate human words to express the vast chasm of affection, that there was so much difference in what our love to God should be, that if you compared love to anything else, it would seem like those things that are dearest to us, that as though we hated them because of our affections. And surely we're to love our mothers and our fathers and our families. But you know, you can set your affection Christians on the wrong things.
Right.
Matthew 6 and 33 said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you." Let me tell you, if you have more affection for anything, more so than you do to get more of God, that is a sin. With all the love of God I had in my heart, I say to you, that is a sin of idolatry.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right.
Look at the Ten Commandments. We think, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit adultery. Well, what does it all start with? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And the first and great commandment is to love the Lord our God with all of our heart. And the second is to love our neighbor as ourselves.
Yes.
And Jesus said that upon these two hang all of the other law and the commandments. So when it comes to what do we desire out of life? What is our master of passion? What are we seeking after? First and foremost, we must set our affection on things above, not on things of the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. We are dead to the things of this world. At one time, we were servants to things which are temporal, and things which would satisfy our selfish desires. But now we're dead to that, and our life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. And verse 5 said, "Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth." Let me get my gun. No, we don't want to talk about guns in churches, I'm sure. But that word mortify means to put to death.
Yes.
And the Bible said, "Mortify your members." Now, that's not talking about me sitting up here with a machine gun, and just blasting those whose name are on the road. It's talking about the members of our body, of our fleshly body, to be dead to our selfish desires and appetites and to self-will. To be dead to all that in our life hid with Christ in God. Amen. Our bodies were made by God from the dust of the earth. He breathed into our nostrils the breath of life, and he said, it is good. And if Adam and Eve would have been faithful to the will of God, they would not have experienced the curse of sin and of death that come upon this earth. God's plan for our bodies is something more glorious than what our bodies are experiencing in this sin-cursed world.
Amen.
Our bodies were created for something more wonderful, more glorious. Hallelujah. Jesus is coming back. He shall appear. And it said, "He shall also appear with him in glory."
Yes.
Hallelujah. Even as his body was changed and glorified, so it will be with us. And it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he appears that we shall be like him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. This mortal body is going to put on immortality. This corruptible body is going to put on incorruption. It's going to be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. But I tell you, if we set our affections on things of earth and we cling to that, that's gonna be gravity that holds us down. But when it comes, it will not experience that kind of change that this body is meant for. People do all kind of things to satisfy their passions and their desires and whatever they have their affection set on. But there's nothing of greater value, of greater worth, of eternal significance than what God wants us to set our affections on, of which will result in the greatest good. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen. For this body.
Yes.
We may get in our mind what's best for us, you know. Maybe a popularity, or a big bank account, or the nicest of material things. Thank God for all of His blessings. Amen. Amen. And if we're faithful to God, I believe He'll bless us with material things. But we need to get our priorities right. We need to have our affections set on things above. As I said this morning, there are things that are not evil in and of themselves, that are lawful. And they can be of service to us. They can even bring us some joy. But if we don't watch it, we'll become enslaved to those things.
Yes.
I mentioned fishing this morning. There are those who could get so enslaved with fishing that their affection would be such that they'd buy a new yacht or motorboat instead of being faithful in their tithing and giving to the church. So no harm in having. If you can't afford a yacht, praise God, thank God I've got me a yacht. Amen. We're going to have something in common. One of these weekends, you're going to say to the pastor and his wife, sail away. And we'll say hallelujah. But you see, the thing about it is getting our priorities straight. Praise God. And if you'll seek the kingdom of God first, then all these things will be added unto you.
Amen.
There's nothing wrong with going fishing. But if you become a slave to that, you see, we've got to be dead to any other master passion that would try to control us and enslave our life and have our life hid in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the result will not be, you're teaching a form of asceticism to where you deny yourself and we're not supposed to be happy. We're not supposed to have joy. We're not supposed to enjoy life. This is how we experience the greatest enjoyment for which God created our bodies. Hallelujah. To where we can have our body obtain that glorified state.
Amen.
Wow. I'm passionate. Hallelujah. About being an eternal life, B.O.B. Amen. Not just a lifelong B.O.B., but an eternal life, B.O.B. Praise God. I'm not feeble, but I'm not as young as I used to be. I don't have the energy that I did at one time. But I'm looking forward to that glorified body. If you want to be passionate about something, just think about that. No more sickness, no more sorrow, no more death. Where are you going to find that? Through your human efforts and search for happiness and that which satisfies and fills the longing of your soul. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. Now stop there. You might wonder what in the world, but it says fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, you lust after that which is evil, and covetousness. That inordinate desire for material things, which is idolatry. If we set our affections on that which satisfies these things, that is a form of idolatry. We are putting it ahead of God. For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. Now, I mentioned fishing, but really, there are a wide range of things which are not necessarily evil within themselves. They're somewhat indifferent, and in a sense, they're permissible. But even those things can become wrong, and they're by not permitted in view of certain principles that Paul mentions. It can have to do with the bad effects, for instance, that it will have upon others. Now, Paul dwells upon this and this thought in more detail in saying, starting off with almost the same words, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. If you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23. Now my main text tonight, or the first verse in the passage, 1 Corinthians 6 and 12, said, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. That's 1 Corinthians 6 and 12. Well, later in that same letter, in chapter 10, verse 23, he says, all things are lawful for me, but all things are not expedient. Have you heard that before? All things are lawful for me, but all things edify not. There's things that within itself, it would not be a sin for me to do, but if it tears other people down instead of building them up, you see. It said, let no man seek his own, but every man another's wealth. Now again, we want to be sure, just like I said, when it mortify your members, that we don't misunderstand it. We don't want to misunderstand this about seeking another's wealth. That doesn't mean what's mine is mine and what's yours is mine and I'm going to take it from you. But you're concerned about the wealth of others, that you want to see them prosper and their needs met. In that sense, let no man seek his own, but every man another's wealth. Don't just be self-centered. Whatsoever is sold in the shambles, that he asketh no question for conscience sake. Now, what it's talking about here among the Gentiles who had their pagan temples and their idolatrous worship is then offered a meat there is a part of their worship, a burnt sacrifice. And then when the service was over, they'd bring it to the marketplace and put it up for sale. And here, Paul said, whatever sold in the shambles, that he asketh no question for conscience sake. You don't ask, was this meat that you're selling, was it, had it been offered in or used in idol worship? He said, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. If any of them that believe not bid you to a feast, and ye be disposed to go, whatsoever is set before you, eat, asking no question of for a conscience sake. You see, that meat in and of itself does not make you any more commendable or less commendable to God. When you eat it, you may have never been inside a pagan temple. Here you are, a Jew, visiting this foreign land, and you haven't went inside a pagan temple, much less offered meat in the worship of that false god. So when you buy that meat in the marketplace, why, it doesn't bother your conscience, and you don't ask any questions about it. So in and of itself, it's not evil. It's permissible to buy it and to eat it. But if any man say unto you, you hadn't asked the question, but if they say unto you, this is offered in sacrifice unto idols, eat not for his sake that showed it, and for conscience sake. So if it's going to offend your brother's conscience, here's a Gentile. Maybe his past, he's been involved in idol worship and idolatry. And for him to eat of that meat, he would associate it with that idolatrous past. Well, rather than offend him, then you don't eat of that meat. For the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Was it lawful or permissible for Paul to eat of such meat as it was sold in the marketplace? Yes, it was permissible. But it wasn't something that he had to do. It was not expedient. And therefore, although in one sense he had the liberty, he restrained his liberty. He brought his body under subjection. One place he said, I became all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. So some, there may be those times that there are things that in and of itself it would not violate our conscience to do. But even so, it's wrong to be. You see, knowledge, Paul said at one place, knowledge puffeth up. I preached on that one Sunday. Knowledge calls people to be high-minded and have a haughty spirit and proud of what they know. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity builds up.
Yes,
or charity edifying. Love will build up. Mm-hmm. And if it offends our brother, then we should not do it. Mm-hmm. But if any say unto you, this offering of the idols, eat not for his sake that showed it, and for conscience sake. For the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. Conscience, I say, but not thine own, but of the other. For why is my liberty judged of another man's conscience? For if I by grace be a partaker, why am I evil spoken of for that of which I give thanks? So, it seems that perhaps that there were those who had gone into the marketplace and they had bought such meat, possibly not being offered the meat, but they went to the marketplace and bought it. Not that they went to somebody's home and it was set before them, but they had went and bought it. And somebody heard about it. And they said to somebody else, I heard this, but don't you tell. And they said, I won't. Some people's been there and done that. So perhaps they were saying this about the Apostle Paul. As he had been there on a previous visit, and somebody might have heard that he had went to the marketplace and he had bought this kind of meat. And he said, who are they to judge my liberty and my conscience? But he said, if it's set before me, I have respect for my brother's conscience. Wherefore, therefore, ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. That's what we're preaching about tonight, is glorifying God in our body. Give none offense, neither to the Jews, nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God. I tell you, there's still some wholeness. Those who carry the name of wholeness or Pentecostal and so on, there's still some of them around that don't wear neckties. If they ask me to preach, I'm not going to change the message for them. If they ask me to come preach, I'll go preach. And when I do, most likely, if I know that that will offend their conscience for me to wear a necktie, I won't wear a necktie.
That's right. Amen.
And we need to be considerate of one another.
Amen.
We must not become exalted and have a big head and be high-minded and haughty because of the great knowledge that we think that we have. To the extent that we're always just seeking our own good and not that of others. Paul said, even as I please all men in all things, not seeking mine own profit, but the profit of many, that they may be saved. Amen. But whatever we do, we're to do it for the glory of God.
Amen.
Not just to be in line with the liberty or freedom we think we have because of our knowledge, but rather how I respond to this and what I say, what I think, what I do. Does it bring glory to God? Hallelujah. That should be number one. You're bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, of which are God's. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Liberty, liberty, liberty. I'm free, I'm free, I'm free. Praise God, I'm not bound, I'm not under law, I'm not under grace, and that gives me a license to do anything I want to. God's grace means that He's so merciful that He has given me a license to sin. Shall we sin that grace may abound?
God forbid.
Hallelujah. We serve an awesome God, a great God. We need to have confidence in His power. The God that I serve, not only can He deliver from the guilt and the penalty of sin, but He can deliver from the power of sin.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And Paul wrote to Titus, somebody might help me on the location of that. said, for the grace of God. Okay, Titus chapter 2, is it verse 15? Okay. Well, they'll tell me here in a minute. But the grace of God that hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodly lusts, goes on to say that we should live holy and godly lives right here in this present world. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 11, starts with verse 11.
Oh. 11 and 12. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. So, here the scriptures in Galatians said, this, verse 16 of chapter 5, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Amen. What flesh? It's talking about this body, this human body, and the desires, sinful desires that it has. If we walk in the Spirit, we'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh, for the flesh lusteth against the Spirit. Now, what does that mean, that lusteth against the Spirit? The flesh lusteth against the Spirit. The flesh wants one thing, and the Spirit wants something else.
That's right.
The flesh lusteth against the Spirit. The flesh desires a certain thing, but the Spirit desires something else. And the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary, the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. You want to please God. You want to do the things that of the Spirit desires. But because of the spiritual warfare and what the flesh desires, you're not, you cannot do the things that you want to. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, they're made known. That's the work that this body does to satisfy its sinful appetites. The works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. If you set your affections on satisfying the flesh, and you become enslaved to those kinds of desires, these are sins that you'll fall into.
Yes.
Amen. It named 17 of them here, but the list could really be much longer, so it said, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I've also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Do what kind of things? Well, those 17 things, but not just that. But and such like. Like what? Like things that we set our affection on to satisfy the sinful desires of the flesh. They shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So that's why, as we read earlier in Colossians chapter 3, verse 5, that it said, mortify your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. For which things' sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. Colossians 3, verses 5 and 6. Romans chapter 14. beginning verse 19. Said, let us therefore follow after. That means to pursue, to go after, to reach after. Follow after the things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify or build up another. For me, destroy not the work of God. That puffed up knowledge, I know I'm right and I know you're wrong. And you get so much in that spirit, you're more concerned about being right than you are so much that you're ready to tear down your brother instead of build him up. For me, don't destroy the work of God just to prove that you're right. Amen?
Amen.
For me, destroy not the work of God. All things in thee are pure. Whatever is pure, it's pure. All things that are pure. But it is evil for that man who eateth with offense. It is good neither to eat flesh, nor to drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth, or is offended, or is made weak. Has thy faith? Have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in that thing which he alloweth. Now, I wasn't planning on mentioning this, but I think it's really a good example. I seem to have stirred up a hornet's nest on Facebook this week. In trying to encourage our young people who find themselves attending a public school to let them know that they can live for God if they find themselves in that situation. And I gave a personal testimony, more detail, I guess, than I ever have about that particular subject. Well, somehow, the father in comments got into a debate about homeschooling versus public schooling. Well, all I was saying, if you find yourself attending a public school in that situation, God can enable you to live a holy life. And I did give this warning. That we need to be careful lest we be perceived like young people in public school is saying that they cannot serve God, that they will surely backslide. Well, and I don't want to paint with too broad a brush, and usually you get the extremist on either side commenting. So I'm not trying to condemn to come against homeschoolers or against those who have their children in public schools. But I will tell you this. There are a lot of kids in public schools that their parents are not Christians. Amen? So, I mean, we won't play them homeschool. There are a lot of kids in public schools. When I say a lot, I mean a lot. And I want to do some research on the percentages of single parent homes. To where that single parent who may have a heartfelt desire to homeschool their child, but they simply cannot afford it. I mean, they're the only source of income in the family, just one parent. Now, thank God for parents who homeschool their kids and take the time and then invest the money and do it for the right reason and more power with them. But God forbid that there would be those who in their knowledge would begin to condemn any and everybody else that's not doing homeschooling. And God have mercy on those kids, on those who have their kids in public school, and they're condemning any and everybody that is doing homeschooling.
That's right. Amen.
I believe that kind of spirit fits in with what I'm preaching tonight. I'm not trying to raise a debate about homeschooling in public schooling, but I'm saying that we need to edify one another and build one another up instead of trying to tear one another down.
Yes,
and not get so haughty and high-minded about what we feel is right. Now certainly, if the Bible explicitly says something, we must be very vocal, and right is right. If nobody does it, and wrong is wrong if everybody does it. But there are indifferent things. But the key to it all is to glorify God. Do that which is for His glory.
Yes. Amen.
Romans 14, verse 22 said, "Hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in that thing of which he alloweth." So here's something that I allow. I don't believe there's anything wrong in doing it. And within itself, there's nothing wrong in buying that meat in the marketplace and eating it. Even if it had been offered to an idol, I've never been inside a temple. I'm not involved in idol worship. But that I have liberty to do, I can condemn myself in doing that by the kind of attitude that I have toward others.
Yes.
So don't condemn yourself in that thing which you allow. And he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. If there's doubt on whether you should do it, then don't do it. We then that are strong are to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. Now let's go into chapter 15, but these divisions were not always there. Let every one of us please his neighbor for his good to edification. So there are things that this body can do that are not sinful in and of itself. But if it violates this principle of tearing down our brothers instead of building them up, then that thing, we become condemned for that thing which otherwise we may be allowed to do. So it comes back down to this. For you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Now there's much more can be said, and we will be said much more later as we're on this series. The book of Colossians talks about the greatness of Christ. And I like to refer to the writings there as in Colossians as speaking of the colossal Christ, the colossal Christ of Colossians. And part of that says that in all things he is to have preeminence. That's first place. He is to be the head. We've been bought with a price. He made this body. He owns this body. It belongs to him. Hallelujah. And so let our desires and our affections first be toward God. The first commandment, loving the Lord with all of our heart. Loving him more than we love ourselves. Are we going to put God first?
Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us here tonight? Hallelujah. Almighty God, we thank you, Lord, for your word which you've given to us. Lord, the words of the Apostle Paul to the Church of God at Corinth, how relevant and meaningful they are to us, still in this day, still fresh. Lord, how they speak to us. Lord, help us, Lord, that we'll not be caught up in so many things. Lord, is Jesus visited Mary and Martha, and Martha was troubled about many things, but Mary was there at his feet. You said of Mary, she have chosen that better part. Hallelujah. Lord, may we choose the best part, that being our affection to you. Hallelujah. And then everything else will take care of itself if we put you first. Oh God, Lord, may we renew, God, our vows to you, our vows of affection. We owe a debt of love we can never repay. Oh, yes, Lord, but we belong to you. We're your slave because you bought us by with your own precious blood, which you shed there on the cross of Calvary. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you